President Chandrika Prasad Santokhi heeft op zaterdag 18 september 2021 tijdens de CELAC-staatshoofdenconferentie de aanwezigen toegesproken. Het staatshoofd heeft de uitdagingen zoals regionale integratie en COVID-19 onder de aandacht gebracht.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Your Excellency, Andrés Manuel López Obrador, President of Mexico, distinguished colleague heads of government, distinguished ministers, distinguished representatives from ECLAC and the European Union, heads of delegations and delegates, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Buenos dias. Mr. President, at the outset, I express my appreciation to the Government of Mexico for hosting the sixth summit of heads of state and government of CELAC. I also salute you for your skillful leadership of your country as you celebrate 211 years of independence. Viva Mexico. Mr. President, distinguished colleagues, today we all face enormous challenges, knowing well that not all of these are caused by us. I urge all of us to demonstrate political will to cooperate as equal partners. Now is the time for solidarity, brotherhood, and international cooperation more than before. This collective responsibility is in the interest of all of us. We have no time to lose, to act, to reform, and to rebuild. Mr. President, especially the small states of the world have been affected severely by the impact of COVID-19 pandemic. Structural debt burden and economic decline resulting in unstable political situations, insecurity, and weak societies. Equally challenging is the limited access to concessional funding due to the unfair classification as middle-income countries, hampering our rebuilding, mitigation, and adaptation efforts. Mr. President, CELAC should support the new vulnerability index proposed by CARICOM. Mr. President, what has the COVID-19 pandemic, which had hit us all, taught us? It has shown us that when in crisis, seemingly international solidarity has little or no meaning, and unveiled the weaknesses of the effectiveness of our international mechanism and global legal infrastructure. Domestically, the social fabric of our societies has changed, including social norms and attitudes. There is the risk of a divided society, those who are fully vaccinated and those not. This creates new forms of conflict, and we have to find a fitting response to this new situation. Yes, Mr. President, we have been able to be resilient, but at what cost? And yes, we have been able to exploit the ICT capabilities, but human beings have a need to communicate face to face like we do today, to have dialogue, to have interaction, and to express our feelings and thoughts. We have seen social compassion through virtual means. Many processes were able to continue thanks to virtual meetings. Our workforce learned to produce from home, and education took place in a different environment. I believe that our efforts now should focus on how we organize ourselves for the new normal with COVID-19 in our lives. We'll need to rebuild our economies create investment opportunities, remove obstacles to close economic cooperation, boost competitiveness and employment, especially among women and youth. In the context of establishing, also through CELAC and other regional cooperation mechanism, a new, fair and equitable multilateral system in the Americas and the world, and new financial instruments need to be developed. The exposed weaknesses of our health system must be addressed with innovative measures and regional cooperation. We also need to pay attention to the education gap that has been caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. Mr. President, the long-term social and psychological aspects of the impact caused by pandemic still need to be understood and addressed as a part of an integral post-COVID strategy. And I'm taking the opportunity, Mr. President, to express my sincere gratitude to all the countries and organizations who have supported my country in the fight against COVID-19. Distinguished colleagues, as we prepare for the COP26 in early November this year in Scotland, we must bear in mind the following. Noble ideals, even with strong political commitments, do not mean much if not supported with adequate and new financial resources. Countries characterized by high forestation, low deforestation, and a carbon negative circumstance must be compensated for maintaining oxygen production and operate as a carbon sink for the world as a whole. Suriname remains committed to the Paris Accord and will continue efforts towards energy transition and a green economy. I hope that, Mr. Chair, that as we develop our economies based on new found resources, double standards will not prevail by placing undue tax and cost burdens on our development potential by those who already have benefited from the same resources. Mr. President, in closing, I call on CELAC to establish a strategic expert group to map out these challenges and identify opportunities and develop fitting, innovative solutions going forward. Mr. Chair, Mr. President, taking into our histories and the diversity of our hemisphere, Suriname strongly supports regional cooperation as well as hemispheric wide collaboration through existing mechanisms. No doubt, yes, we need to reflect on how this America's multilateralism is exercised in the process of strengthening the regional integration and the regional cooperation. Finally, Mr. President, the Republic of Suriname remains committed to regional integration, promotion of democracy, good governance, and strengthening of the rule of law as a fundamental framework for economic prosperity, sustained peace, and international cooperation. I thank you. Muchas gracias. May God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President.